Last class we are discussing about planning of harbors. Planning of harbor means the entrance channel, the turning circle, the alignment of breakwater. These are all parts of harbor layout, but in addition there are certain numerical studies that are being carried out related to maneuvering of the ship through the entrance channel. You have real time maneuvering also for the vessel inside, or you can that is a pilot of the ship can sit in a console of a computer and see how you can navigate the ship inside the entrance channel and turning circle, or you can do a numerical study also giving the different parameters to see how the navigation takes place. Other study is important study is about the tranquility. Tranquility means you will assume the waves from different directions and find out what is the waves inside. The one of the problem is the entrance. Suppose the wave is coming through this side, it will penetrate through the entrance and it will go inside. So we have to keep the orientation of the entrance in such a way that the predominant direction of the wave is not in this direction. But for the wind, which is also critical, it's very difficult to see, because in a particular day the wind direction may change from this side to this side and things like that. So that's very difficult, but we have to consider the different types of winds also. That is as far as the ship maneuvering is concerned. The other type of study is tranquility. Tranquility means what is the wave height inside the harbor basin. That is when the waves are coming from this side, the waves may diffract and go inside. What is the wave height outside and what is the wave height inside? For that we can do numerical modeling. There are certain commercial softwares like Mike 21 which are being used to study the tranquility. In our department we have our own softwares developed also for this particular case. We have another thing called as harbor resonance. Harbor resonance means when there is a cyclonic condition, that time generally the wave period is very long, and I will be discussing some part of waves in one of the class. Corresponding to a wave period we have a wavelength. Suppose that wavelength is multiples of this harbor basin dimensions, then a resonance will take place. When a resonance takes place, whatever waves which are inside, the waves will go on increasing as the resonance takes place. So normally what precaution that is taken is, whenever any cyclonic storm is there, the vessels which are berthed inside the harbor basin, they are asked to go out, because when the harbor resonance takes place, the motion of the vessel is very large, it may go and touch the bottom of the seabed. So what they do is, they take the vessel from the harbor basin, take it to deep waters, more than 30 meters water depth, because here the water depth is only about 17-18 meters, here about 14-15 meters. So when they take the vessel to outside with the water depth of more than 40-50 meters, then even if the vessel is going up and down, it will not touch the bottom of the vessel. And the orientation of the vessel, they will put a single anchor. It itself weather vanes, it is called as weather vaning. It rotates itself so that it is always in the head sea condition. That is not possible inside the harbor basin. This is for bigger size vessels, but in a fishing harbor you have sufficient water depth, more than 5-6 meter water depth, draft is only 2 meters. The fishing harbor, when there is a cyclone, they will come inside. So the fisherman will come inside. The commercial harbor, the vessels will go outside whenever a cyclone is coming. Any harbor, they raise the flag. The flag is having numbers from 1 to 10. So when a cyclone warning is there, when cyclone is a few hundred kilometers from the harbor, they will start with flag number 3, and it is approaching, it will go to 6, 7, 8, 9 and all. After 7 they have to start moving the vessels outside. So the recent cyclone in Chennai, I think they have gone up to flag number 9, that is what they have done. So these are the two things we have to study. One is the ship maneuvering, another is what is the numerical study on the waves. Two kind of studies. One is throughout the year we have to find out what is the predominant wave direction, maybe few directions and wave period and wave height, three parameters: direction of the wave, height of the wave and the period of the wave we have to study. Then during storm, whether harbor resonance takes place. All of you know about resonance, I think. So same thing happens here also. And one of the precautionary measures, not precautionary, one of the measures to reduce the harbor resonance is whenever the waves are coming inside, there should be some place where the wave energy will get dissipated. The natural dissipation is the beach. If you go to the beach, the waves come and break. Like that, we have to provide what is known as a spending beach. We can provide somewhere here a spending beach, means a slope, natural slope, which can absorb the wave energy, that can be provided at this location. So last class we are discussing about the infrastructure for the harbor, like breakwaters, entrance channel, training circle, dock basin and the berth. And I will be discussing about certain planning aspects for the entrance channel and training circle using our IS code. So we have discussed about breakwaters, entrance channel, the types of channel, then training circle. Training circle means the size or diameter of the training circle. It depends on the geometry of the water area available and the berth arrangement. So these are the two things which control what should be the size or diameter. Typically the diameter is about 1.7 to 2 times the length of the largest vessel. Another important parameter is the water depth also is increased in the training circle. We said about 10% of the undercill clearance in the navigation channel, maybe in turning circle they may increase the water depth. Then dock basin, each dock will have a water depth maintained constantly, and this depends on the vessel size, tranquility and salinity condition. What is the effect of salinity in draft of the vessel? Somebody is there, naval architecture, who is that fellow? Tell me. Now fresh water, a vessel is playing, then it goes to salt water. What happens to the draft? Why? Density is higher, salt water. So vice versa is more dangerous. Suppose a vessel is playing in a salt water and it is coming to a fresh water, suddenly the draft increases. So the underkill clearance reduces. So that is one of the aspects. Then the water area requirement is about the berthing area where the vessel is berthed for loading and unloading operation, the passage and maneuvering area and the training basin. That means in a harbor layout we are more worried about the water area requirement. In the port layout we should be worried more about the land area requirement. So port means we should consider the planning of water area as well as planning of the port area. Now we will go through this code, this IS 4651 part 5 1960, and it is reaffirmed in 1997. I think this every alternate year they reaffirm, but now IIT Madras, our department, has been given the responsibility to have a relook at this, all the codes, and we have revised part 4. Part 5 we are planning to revise. This is called as Bureau of Indian Standards, and it is code of practice for planning and design of ports and harbors. This is for all the IS 4651, the title. The title for part 5 is layout and functional requirements. So here you have the details that are given in this code, like the different chapters which you can go through: navigation channel, harbor basin, These are the two things which we have studied in the harbor lecture. Another important thing is how to select the harbor site. This is also important. When L&T wanted to develop the shipbuilding facility in India, they have visited three sites, one in Gujarat, two in Tamil Nadu, one is Tuticorin, another is Chennai. Based on that, they have selected the site. The selection of site not only depends on the technical requirements, but also the commercial requirements. Both are important. Now we will go through this harbor site, selection of harbor site. One is access, another is size and depth. Main thing that is required is the direct access with the communication, with the connectivity with rivers, highways, canals and railways. Nowadays the air connectivity is also required. The size and depth, that is also a requirement. Adequate size of area and seafront. Typically, because of so much of port development that is taking place, it is very difficult to get a seafront of more than 2 kilometers. That is for the width of the harbor facility. And we should also find out what is the requirement of dredging. If the water contour, that is water depth contour, 10 meter is available very close by, maybe at a distance of less than a kilometer, then excessive dredging can be avoided. And another important parameter is room for future expansion. India is inching towards 100 million tons per port. Whereas abroad it is going very high. At Shanghai, where we have the maximum throughput, is about 40 million TEU. 40 million TEU means very close to 500 million tons, single port. What we are handling in JNPT is 4 million TEU, 1/10 of what is being handled in Shanghai. The expansion is very much required. So, only for the captive ports, they are giving restricting the width to about 2 kilometers. Other ports, they can go up to 5 kilometers and things like that. Then we, when we select, we have to decide about the physical and topographical features, that is sheltering from winds and ocean waves. It can be by natural phenomena like headlands, offshore shoals and bars. Or we can provide artificial requirements such as breakwaters. So, headland means a projection of hilly area inside the river, inside the sea. Vizag, we have the dolphin hill, that is a headland. Offshore shoals and bars, if you take Kattupalli L&T, we have the offshore shoals and bars on the northern side. Otherwise, you have to go for this artificial breakwaters. But the advantage of headland is it offers protection both from the winds as well as the waves. Another important consideration is the subsoil condition. If you have a rock, it is very good for port structures. Whereas, if you have the rock, the cost is more for dredging. So, very soft bottom does not provide good holding conditions for anchor. So, you should avoid a very soft soil where if it is existing, but sometimes it is unavoidable. The other important parameter is dredging, that is minimum capital and maintenance dredging. So, capital dredging means once you start developing the harbor, that time you have what is known as the capital dredging. Maintenance dredging is typically about 10% of capital dredging. So, when you dredge the in the sea artificially, you are increasing the depth, the velocity reduces and it gets deposited. So, we have to go for maintenance dredging. And freedom from dredging large quantities of rock or other hard bottom should be an important consideration. In India, all these conditions are violated in certain locations, but still we develop ports in those areas because of various reasons, political reasons, commercial reasons and all. Tuticorin port, we have the rock, we are spending a lot of money. In Mumbai JNPT also, the development is restricted, it is not growing like Shanghai. Mainly the reason is we have the rock, up to minus 14 meter only we have dredged. For a port to have high capacity, we need at least 18-20 meter water depth. So, once it is rock, the cost is increasing. Dredging means normally the cost is about 200 to 300 rupees per cubic meter. If you want to dredge material, 200 to 300 rupees per cubic meter. If it is rock, it goes to 2000 to 3000. That is how the cost increases, it is one of the problems. Another problem is when you do the dredging rock, we have to use explosives and it creates some environmental problem. This point is very important, that is the shoreline stability. So, India, we are doing lot of scientific studies on shoreline stability. We are identifying certain locations which are prone to erosion. And we suggest that you do not provide any port facility where it is a eroding coast. Eroding coast, it may be due to natural or man-made reasons. Natural reason itself, there are certain locations which are eroding. Those locations, it is preferable not to build a port facility. So, non-eroding shorelines should be preferred. The land adjacent to the shoreline should gradually slope away from the beach, and location where we have topographical, there are two things, one is on the seaside, another is on the land side. If we have cliffs, that and all will create problems because you have to level the surface, so that problem will take place. And the drainage also is very important, it should be naturally drained. So, there are five aspects which we have discussed, one is upland drainage, shoreline stability, dredging, sheltering from winds and ocean waves and subsoil conditions. These are the things which govern the location. Then we have other hydrographic and hydrological factors, one of them is tide, another is current. They have written location with tidal range should be avoided, but if you see Gujarat where we have very large tidal variation, they use it to their advantage. Another problem is if we have about let us say 6 meter tide, the vessel in high tide will be 6 meter above the low tide. That means from the side, when it goes to low tide from the top of the berth, it is 2 story down the ship. So, that is a very difficult problem for mooring and things like that, and whenever there is a large tidal variation, the current velocity also is very high. So, it is preferable not to create a facility where we have more than 4 knots. These are general considerations. Once you are planning a greenfield port, you should avoid that L&T Kattupalli, they have not gone to Gujarat. Mainly one of the reason is this large tide and current variation. Meteorological factors, location subject to pronounced severe and frequent storms should be avoided. There are certain locations where the cyclone passes. If we take the east coast, generally the cyclones will hit Nagapattinam or Kadalur, it generally does not come to Chennai, it will stay near Chennai and it will go to Andhra. Andhra, there are certain locations like Machilipatnam and other places where it will cross. Nellore is another place where it will cross. it is a predetermined locations where the cyclone chooses to cross. Normally the cyclone does not cross south of Nagapattinam, but Dhanushkodi it has crossed once. So we know where the cyclone crosses, we have this data also available. Another important requirement is the construction materials, because the transportation of construction material is not only expensive, but also it creates lot of environmental problem, because it creates lot of pollution, traffic congestion, this also is a consideration. This also nowadays is important, strategic and security conditions, this also should be given importance. So we have we always problem with Pakistan, so we should not have certain facilities which can be targeted very close to Pakistan border. The security for harbor facility is one of the important considerations, because most of the cargo which is coming, it comes through the harbors only. Next, certain details about navigation channel is given. You please go through this. The type of channel already given in the PowerPoint about unrestricted, semi-restricted and fully restricted channels. The curves and bends, we need special consideration. Here we have given two figures. Figure 1 is for semi restricted channel and figure 2 is for fully restricted channel. The free channel means there is no dredging, that is the first one. Unrestricted channel, unrestricted channel means there is no dredging required, sufficient water depth is available at a particular site, that is called as unrestricted channel. Semi restricted channel means you do only part of the dredging, already we have sufficient water depth, but not sufficient water depth, but already we have some water depth. Let us say we need to develop a port for about 16 meter water depth, a 10 meter is available, then what you do is you create a facility, harbor facility on 10 meter water depth, then you dredge only for 6 meter, this is called as semi restricted channel. Fully restricted means right from the water level you restrict completely, that is called as fully restricted channel. I may ask this question, so you have to draw and explain. Whenever the questions are asked in this course, mostly I would like you to draw the figures and explain. Then there is what is called as the stopping distance. Normally when the vessel is stopped, then it is going inside the harbor. From the point the vessel stops to the point where it is going to the turning circle, we need a protection from the waves and winds, that means we need the breakwaters and natural protection. So what is the stopping distance? Stopping distance, any engineering practice, whenever we have a parameter to be defined, we should always define with reference to some other parameters. So if you take the stopping distance, I say it is related to ship lengths. Now suppose I want to know what should be the width of this channel, either this width or this width, it depends on what? Beam of the ship, that is correct. If we want to find out what should be the depth, depends on what?
Draft of the
vessel. So I have given a lecture in which I have told you what is the length, beam and draft of the vessel. So based on that you have to find out. So if you see here, the vessel in loaded condition, we need about 7 to 8 times the ship's length. The vessel in ballast, vessel in ballast means it is a light draft, all the cargo has been unloaded and the ship is moving out or moving in, that is called as vessel in ballast. There we need 3 to 5 times the ship's length. Can you tell me why we need more length of the ship
in loaded condition compared to ballast condition, that is a light condition?
What could be the reason?
As high mass, so high momentum.
When the vessel is in a loaded condition, we have the mass is the maximum. When you are stopping the vessel means not applying brake, stopping the engine. So it is moving at certain speed, some acceleration is there for the vessel. When you stop it, there is a deceleration. The energy required to be dissipated is mass into the deceleration. So that is more because the mass is more. That is why we need more length for loaded condition and less length for unloaded condition or light condition. The next parameter is about the depth. For the depth, it depends on the size, draft, shape and speed of hull of the design vessel, trim of vessel when moving through water. I will describe about trim and all in another class. The current velocity, squat also I will discuss in some other class. So the channel is fully restricted, semi restricted or unrestricted, number of lanes in the channel, wind and wave condition. So this parameter what we are calling the wind and wave, we have to study about this wind and wave. So you should, there is some statistics involved in about the wind and wave, it is not constant. The two parameters are used, one is operation, another is extreme. Operational wind, operational wave, extreme wind and extreme wave. The operational consideration, the wind speed will be much less, then only you will bring the vessel inside. The wind is more, the ship will be anchored outside the harbor basin, it won't come inside. Then the tidal variation, this is very important in certain ports which are called as tidal ports, they use the tide to bring the vessel. For example, Kandla, it is in a creek from the Gulf of Kutch. They bring the vessel where there is a very open channel only, unrestricted channel, where the water depth is only about 9 meter in low tide, but when high tide comes it goes to 14 meter. There is a narrow stretch, there is what is called a Sogal channel, through which they will bring the vessel only during high tide. So the time is important, whenever a ship maneuvering takes place, it is always related to tide. The tides are not normally occurring at the same time every day, it is slightly different. So there is a tide chart which is published by the Survey of India, every year it is published, January it is there. They give for major ports in India what is the time for high tide as well as for low tide. So you see the tide and bring it, so this is very important. The dredging pattern and frequency, so this is mainly for maintenance dredging. Certain ports the maintenance dredging is done throughout the year, whereas certain ports it is done in seasonal. The salinity we already discussed, bottom material also we discussed. If it is a clay soil, the bottom clearance required for clay will be less, whereas if it is rock it is more. Then this is called as sounding accuracy. So when you do a hydrographic survey, there is accuracy. See, what you measure is 10.1 meter, the accuracy of the instrument, it may not sense 10.095, so it gives 10.1, that you have to take care. What is the net underkill clearance, these are the various things. Then about the width of the channel, you please go through this details what is given here. Normally this one lane channel, this is a restricted channel. When there is B, that is the beam of the vessel, when the vessel is to be going only within this place, that is called as the maneuvering lane, we are deciding this width to be equal to 1.8 to 2 times the beam of the vessel. because due to wind and current, the vessel being in this central position, it can move this side, it cannot move very much. It is called as maneuvering lane. And there is a bank, to the bank the clearance is 0.75 to 1.5 b, this side 0.75 to 1.5 b. You may wonder why we are giving two values, two ranges. It depends on the site condition. Each side the current speed will be more. The current speed is high, we have to go for the higher values. The current speed is less, we have to go for a lower values. But it should not be less than the minimum value, that is 1.5 plus 1.8, that is 3.3 times beam of the vessel you have to provide. But sometimes they may go for slightly less than this, but it should be based on detailed numerical calculation, as well as we have this simulators where they create the navigation channel. Simulator is there is a simulator in Indian Maritime University. So they have the layout of the harbor, the ship's pilot sits there and they create various conditions. He does the maneuvering, how the ship is moving under. Normally we use only two lane channels. So here it is given one lane channel, the bottom width varies from 3.3 times to 5 times the beam of the vessel. Beam means the largest beam of the vessel. Typically it is about Panamax size is about 32.3 meters. So vessel the maneuvering lane will be, the one lane channel will be about 150 to 200 meters, that is for single channel. When a greenfield port is developed, they will start with a one lane channel, then subsequently they will move on to a two lane channel. So when I want you to draw the figure, you please draw the ship at least like this, do not draw in some other manner. I want the proportion of the beam to the depth to be almost equal to the reality, and the bottom clearance also. Whenever you draw the figure, you should take care of that. And when I say 1.8 to 2b, I do not want you to draw with a scale, but still if this is b, this should likely look like 2b, not 3b or 5b, something like that. Should not come very close also. So you try to practice. And this passing clearance also should be there. I think he has not given the passing clearance here in this figure. Maybe it is about the same as this bank clearance. And we have two vessels going here. There are certain waves that are developed when the ship is moving, and there are certain effects when this vessel is moving due to the formation of some vertices and other aerodynamic properties. There is some additional forces that is coming onto the nearby ship. So that is why we have to create clearance. The bottom width should be about 5.1 to 8b, that should be the bottom width. When I say bottom width, it is the width at the bottom, not at the water line. So whenever you read, generally we do not read it with lot of concentration. So any word that is used in a code has a meaning, it may not be explained in the code. Bottom width means the width at the bottom. That means what is the width at the water line? Width at the water line is very difficult. Suppose it is a rocky strata, this can stand vertical. In that case the top width and bottom width is same. It is a very soft clay, there is a slope here. What could be the slope? There are so many civil engineers here, no? What will be the slope? So when you are dumping sand from a lorry, sand is forming an angle of repose. What will be the angle? 30 degrees. So in slope, if you say, it can be from 1:1.5 to 1:2, that is one vertical to 1.5 horizontal. In clay soil, that is mostly experienced in many of the ports in India, this slope can be one vertical to 10 horizontal, it can be so much. And whenever there is a tsunami or cyclonic storm passes, even if there is a steep slope, it becomes flattened. So we can take 1 in 3 as a general guideline for this bottom slope. Why this slope is important? The slope is important because the dredging quantity, you have to calculate the volume. For that you need the bottom width as well as the side slope. There is lot of financial stake associated with this dredging quantity. The slope, whether it is 1:3 or 1:1.5 or 1:2, the quantity can vary from variation can be 5%, 10% or even sometimes 15%. So that is a very huge quantity. Normally nowadays we pay for the actual quantity what is dredged. Earlier people used to specify that this should be dredged to a particular slope because they want the stability of the slope. We do so by mathematical calculation, the slope comes 1:10, they want to study 1:10. So we will discuss the other things in the next class.